And the next item of business is, I don't know if there's a conversation that the Chamber needs to be aware of because it's quite noisy. So the next item of business is a statement by Cabinet Secretary Hamza Youssef on NHS Scotland pandemic pressures. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of his statement, so therefore there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Hamza Youssef, Cabinet Secretary, around 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This week, the number of people in hospital with COVID-19 has, of course, reached the highest level since the start of the pandemic. It is having a significant impact on our health and social care services, although especially in A&E, right across the entire system. Our health board colleagues, those working on the front line, all tell us that the last 2 weeks have been the toughest in the pandemic so far. And the latest data, of course, shows some of the lowest performance against the four-hour A&E target we have seen. This level of pressure impacts on patients and staff, and I want to start firstly by thanking our NHS and social care staff, who we owe a huge debt of gratitude to, and who are continuing to provide vital treatment and optimal patient care during some of the most challenging times, but also to patients and those who have in any way been either inconvenienced or indeed are suffering because of the current pressures. I have no hesitation in apologising for that suffering and for that inconvenience. And I appreciate the patience that every person is showing at this extremely challenging time. There are, of course, a number of contributing factors impacting on A&E services. They include a record number of people in hospital with COVID, infection prevention and control measures currently in place, workforce pressures that are exacerbated by record levels of community transmission, increased attendances to A&E services, high levels of delayed discharge and longer length of stay in hospital. Today, there are 2,322 COVID patients in our hospitals. That number has more than doubled since February. It's now past the previous peak of last winter when we had 2,053 patients in hospital with COVID in January 2021. Using the latest published COVID-19 modelling, we anticipate this may well continue to increase over the next couple or few weeks. The increase in cases and hospitalisation is largely due to the dominance of the more transmissible Omicron BA2 variant, which accounts for around 90% of all reported cases. The latest ONS survey data shows that 1 in 14, over 7% of people in Scotland in the community have tested positive for COVID, or did test positive for COVID, in the week to the 12th of March. This is the highest estimate Scotland has ever had since the beginning of the survey in autumn 2020. Thanks to the excellent progress that has been made on vaccinations, the recent rise in cases and hospitalisation has not, thankfully, translated into increased cases of severe illness requiring intensive care. However, this level of continued pressure is challenging in the context of a health service that has been dealing with sustained and relentless demand and pressure for nearly 2 years. Unlike in wave one of the pandemic, when services were stood down, we are, of course, remobilising our NHS. In addition, infection prevention and control guidance remains in place and is important for maintaining safety within our hospitals. However, this undoubtedly creates additional complexities and inefficiencies when it comes to moving people through the system. For example, patients cannot wait in the discharge lounge or sit out to wait for discharge drugs. This means they must wait in bed space longer than required, which then, of course, requires to be deep cleaned prior to any new admission. Also, patients cannot access normal transport. They must travel either on their own or with other patients with COVID. I'm able to advise, though, that each of the four UK nations are looking towards developing an exit strategy from the existing UK winter IPC guidance, and considering what a return to business as usual looks like going forward. These next steps include a range of changes which, if implemented, would help to relieve some of the pressure the system is currently experiencing. But ultimately, if we can control community transmission of COVID, we will help alleviate the current pressures we're under. On workforce, Presiding Officer, the level of NHS staff absences attributed to those testing positive for COVID has increased by almost 100%. It has doubled over the last 4 weeks to almost 4,700 people. This increase in staff absence puts an incredible strain on the delivery of health services. Asymptomatic healthcare workers are asked to continue to test twice weekly. This includes all NHS staff and patient-facing primary care independent contractor staff too. However, we are reviewing this regularly as part of the testing transition plan. In the latest week, ending the 22nd of March, an average of 6,000 NHS staff, or around 3.4% of the NHS workforce, were reported absent each day for a range of reasons related to COVID-19. We've worked hard throughout the pandemic to maintain record staffing levels across our NHS, and those NHS staffing levels are, of course, up by over 28,000 whole-time equivalents under this government to a record high. We've invested in growing our workforce by just under 10% in the last 2 years to enhance our services capacity to deal with the new pressures they've faced. We recognise the scale of improvements required and are working closely with partners to accelerate domestic and international recruitment to Scotland. A record £300 million of new investment to help services deal with system pressures over winter introduced a range of direct workforce investments and new measures to support boards' capacity for both domestic and international recruitment. We're investing £11 million over the next 5 years in new national and international recruitment campaigns, and we've established the new Centre for Workforce Supply to provide labour market intelligence. We're also recruiting at least 200 registered nurses from overseas, with funding of £4.5 million available to health boards to take this forward. We've asked boards to recruit 1,000 Agenda for Change staff to provide additional capacity across a variety of health and care services, with funding of up to £15 million. We're working with boards to develop nationally coordinated recruitment campaigns to actively recruit nursing and medical staff within the UK. A Ban Nurse 5 campaign launched on the 18th of February. Scotland has, as we know, the best paid NHS staff in the UK, and we've made available £12 million this year to support the wellbeing of our staff. But demand is clearly putting pressure, an increased demand is clearly putting pressure on our acute sites and right across our NHS and social care systems. In the latest week, attendances at A&E departments increased to 26,000, the highest in 6 months. The last time COVID inpatients were above 2,000, that was in January 2021, attendances to A&E department were at 16,000 for the week. That's an increase of nearly 40%, putting even more pressure on stretched services. We're also hearing that people are presenting with higher acuity. They're coming to hospital sicker, and as a result, having to spend longer in hospital, with the average length of stay up around 1 day, 16% on historic levels, meaning a greater bed requirement. These issues, of course, are not unique to Scotland, and our A&E departments continue to be the best performing in the UK for over the last 6 years. And latest comparable data for January shows that Scotland's A&E performance was 11.4% and 14.1% better than England and Wales, respectively. Our colleagues in the community are also experiencing challenges. The current spread of COVID in the community is creating significant problems for our workforce. This is felt in social care, but also our health and social care partnerships, I know, are working incredibly hard to support people both in the community and also those who are coming out of hospital too. All partnerships are now involved in our discharge without delay programme to improve discharge planning arrangements and reduce length of stay in hospital. For planned care, our NHS colleagues are working exceptionally hard to restart elective activity. COVID workforce and bed capacity pressures do, however, continue to create challenges. And we're now receiving reports that some restarted electives are having to be postponed again to deal with that increasing pressure that our health boards are facing at this immediate time. Extended waits for elective treatment, of course, increases the risk of deteriorating health and social care outcomes, and the additional impact that has on unscheduled care. So we are working closely with health boards and partners to support planning and delivery of the high-level commitments in the NHS recovery plan published last summer. We're also investing in our hospital at home programme. We've enhanced our hospital at home services right across Scotland over the last few weeks, with further capacity expected to come on stream by the end of this month. This work is critical as we move into the recovery phase, and we're already beginning to see some of the fruits of that input. During the six-month period, September 2021 to February 2022, 4,500 patients received care from a hospital at home service. So that's 4,500 people who, without these services, would have had to go to hospital. This resulted in 26,700 occupied bed days for hospital at home services. So again, we've avoided 26,700 acute hospital occupied bed days. The redesign of urgent care programme is of course incredibly important too. We have supported it with £23 million this year. It's another example of positive work that we are undertaking. Through this work, we're strengthening alternative services so that those who think they need to go to A&E, but their illness is not a critical emergency or life-threatening, they can be seen or treated at home or indeed in the community. We are, of course, increasing funding to NHS 24 too, so that they can get people can get good advice, but quickly as well, because I know that some waiting times in NHS 24 have also been too long. I have been upfront and honest, presiding officer, about the scale of the challenge in terms of our NHS recovery. It will take time. The recovery will not be a matter of weeks or months. It will take years. And we are working closely with boards to look forward together to deliver a package of measures to support sustainable recovery in the potential event of future COVID-19 waves. How can we insulate that recovery from those future waves? That is the work that we are undertaking. We will continue to fund our national treatment centres, the £400 million in that national treatment centre programme, which will again help us in our recovery, particularly around elective care. The funding for the NHS for 2022-2023 is of course at record levels of £18 billion. Just to conclude, presiding officer, health and social care services do continue to face unprecedented pressures. There's simply no denying that. I hope I have managed to set the context of why they are under such severe pressure, and I will work day and night, as I have done since being appointed this role, to make sure that we are supporting the men and women who are working so hard in our health and social care system. And once again, I end where I started by thanking them for their incredible efforts over the course of this pandemic.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow 20 minutes or thereby, given the extra time the Cabinet Secretary took for his statement, for questions, after which we will move on to the next item of business. It would be helpful if those members who wish to ask a question were to press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you. I'd like to start by thanking all the heroic NHS staff who have worked throughout the pandemic and are still working hard now. This statement is essentially setting out a list of excuses and patting yourself on the back, Cabinet Secretary. How can you possibly do this with the problems we are facing in the Scottish NHS? The Cabinet Secretary talks of spending more per head than in England, but with the Barnett formula, funding should be billions more. The Cabinet Secretary continues the self-congratulations by stating we have more staff in our NHS. Well, that would be fine if demand was the same as it was even 5 years ago. Demand is significantly rising, and actually we have record vacancies in our NHS from nursing to physios. And this is not all due to COVID. Your lack of credible workforce planning and a flimsy COVID recovery plan has led us to this. So, Cabinet Secretary, what will you do to tangibly deliver help to us today, not in years? Plus, this was originally meant to be an A&E statement. So what immediate tangible help will you be giving to A&E departments? Because I fear that you are making excuses here and there is nothing to actually tackle the problem.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm afraid it's simply incorrect. It's not a list of excuses. What I'm doing is setting out a context of why we are facing the pressures we're facing. And I would have thought that that would have been helpful, given that people are rightly asking why is performance where it is? Why are people having to wait too long? And actually, he calls our recovery plan flimsy. If it was so flimsy, why on earth did his colleagues in London copy it? They imitated our plan. Our 10% additional capacity that we'll create is a central plank of their recovery plan. So it's not a flimsy recovery plan. But what I'm trying to say to members across the chamber is we have to insulate our recovery as best we possibly can against future shocks and against future waves of the pandemic. So I've said it already in great detail. I don't intend to rehearse it because of brevity. All of the funding that we are providing our health boards, from the £300 million winter plan to the £20 million additional for our Scottish Ambulance Service. And if we had not made that investment, the things would have been far worse than they are. So I'm actually very proud of the fact that we have the higher NHS workforce per head than in England, where his party are in charge. Our A&E outperforms England, where his party are in charge. We have the best paid staff in the UK. We have more GPs per head than they have in England, where his party are in charge. And we have more dentists per head than where his party is in charge. So no wonder the people of Scotland continue to trust the SNP to run our health service as opposed to the Conservatives. So this is not a list of excuses. What I have demonstrated today is the context of why we have these challenges and how this government is stepping up to that challenge.
I call Jackie Bailey.
And I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's statement, but I do look forward to a time when he is not just commenting on the context or how bad the problem is, but that he is actually taking action. The number of patients waiting in A&E is at an all-time high. In fact, it's higher than at any time since records began in 2015. That is assuming, of course, Presiding Officer, that you can get to A&E, if you can get your call answered by NHS 24, and if you can get an ambulance to show up. Can I also thank the staff who are working tirelessly? But they are being let down by this government. Everyone is waiting for this Cabinet Secretary to do something. But all he has are the answers he gave in October 2021. These initiatives have not worked. Delayed discharge has in fact increased taking up capacity in our hospitals, and that has a direct impact on A&E. As John Thompson of the Royal College of Emergency Medicine said, things cannot continue as they are, more patients will come to harm, and staff are facing increasing distress. Perhaps the NHS would have been more resilient if the Cabinet Secretary's predecessors hadn't cut beds, had fixed the workforce crisis, and had sorted social care. But these problems are not new, and they predated the pandemic. The Cabinet Secretary is playing fast and loose with the lives of Scots. We need more than sticking plaster solutions and more excuses. So when will he come to the Chamber with a plan that will actually make a difference?
Cabinet Secretary.
Listening to Jackie Bailey, you would not have realised that we are in the midst of a global pandemic. You just would not have thought that there is a global pandemic. Not only that we are in the midst of that global pandemic, but, and she's shouting excuse. We have the highest level of number of people in hospital with COVID. We have the highest level of community transmission because of COVID. We have high levels of workforce absence because people are testing positive for COVID. We can't just magic away the pandemic as much as I would like to, and I suspect as much as Jackie Bailey would like to. So we are taking action. She asked, what action are we taking? I can again go through the list of the funding that we have provided. But on top of that, some immediate action is that additional funding for hospital at home. And for example, I've just given her detail of how we've just managed to save 26,700 acute hospital occupied bed days. And delayed discharges, yes, she's absolutely right, have been going in the wrong direction. But of course, when we have so many outbreaks in so many care homes, it becomes more difficult to discharge people into the community. And actually, in some areas, we are making progress. I met with Edinburgh City Council and Edinburgh Health and Social Care Partnership. And since the end of January to this, to the present day, they've actually managed to see a reduction and standard delay. So some health boards and some local authorities and health and social care partnerships are moving in the right direction. So again, of course, if we can keep COVID under control, that will be our best tool in order to aid our recovery.
I would ask, as we move from front bench questioners, to seek to have more succinct questions and answers. I call David Torrens to be followed by Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. GP receptionists are trained to guide callers to the best care for their healthcare needs. A specialist is not always a GP that's best placed to help. However, many, including those in my constituency, have reported experiencing an increase in abuse when they are doing their best to help. With the very stark figures announced today, it is likely that GP services will see an increase in those looking for an appointment. Would the Cabinet Secretary join me in urging callers to take guidance from GP's receptionists as they play an important role in getting people to care in the right place? And he joined me in thanking those receptionists in my constituency and throughout Scotland for the incredible dedication and commitment they have shown in the past 2 years and beyond, and that this kind of behaviour is unacceptable from the public.
Cabinet Secretary.
I agree wholeheartedly with David Torrance, and I want to place on record my thanks to all GP staff, from the GPs, of course, themselves, to the receptionists, to all of the multidisciplinary team that work in the GPs. Practice abuse towards any of our NHS and social care staff is completely unacceptable. And I don't buy into this narrative at all that GPs and their staff are not working hard to see patients. They are working extremely hard to see patients. It's probably why, in the blog written by the chair of the BMA's GP committee, he congratulated the Scottish Government for the approach it has taken, and in very stark contrast to the approach that the UK Government has taken.
I call Sue Webber, who is joining us remotely, to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Yesterday afternoon, the cross-party group on miscarriage heard that midwives are leaving the profession in droves. They cannot cope with the stress placed upon them by workforce pressures. Right across the sector, There are simply not enough of the right skilled staff on duty at any one time. Midwives are underfunded and overworked and quite simply burnt out. This statement offers nothing new for them. No additional support and no additional funding. At what point will the Health Secretary cease this self-congratulatory tone, get out of his echo chamber and bring forward a credible plan to relieve the long-standing pressures on the midwifery profession, pressures which long predate the pandemic?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I disagree with Sue Webber's characterisation. There's nothing self-congratulatory. All the government has done and I have done is set the context of why we are in the challenging position that we're in. We have, and where I agree with Sue Webber, is the well-being of our staff is absolutely central, absolutely central. Every single clinician that I speak to, every single member of our NHS and social care that I speak to is frankly knackered. And therefore, the additional funding that I have brought forward and the government have brought forward for staff well-being is to address that very, very issue. And what I would say to Sue Webber is what I said to Jackie Bailey and to Sandesh Gohani, that if we can control community transmission of COVID, that will significantly help us to alleviate pressure. And let me place on record my thanks for the excellent work that midwives do right across Scotland.
I call Evelyn Tweed, followed by Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Vaccines are the best line of defence, and fortunately, while we are seeing very high numbers in hospital, the vaccine is clearly having an impact on the number of lives lost to COVID. Is the Cabinet Secretary optimistic that the uptake of the spring booster amongst those eligible is set to be as widespread and positive as the previous booster?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I'm confident and I agree with Evelyn Tweed's articulation that vaccines have been a game changer, and I would encourage anybody who has not had their first, second, their third dose, their booster, if they haven't had any of the doses they're eligible for, to please come forward, because vaccines are our number one tool in the fight against the virus.
Paul O'Kane, followed by Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This week, NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde once again issued a warning not to attend A&E unless your situation is life-threatening. This warning has been used repeatedly by the board since August, and instead people have been advised to use NHS 24, but we know that from September to January, 240,000 calls went unanswered. That leaves people in a very precarious position and not knowing where to turn, often in very serious situations. I note in the statement the re-announcement of the opening of the Dundee Contact Centre. But can the Cabinet Secretary clarify how many additional staff are required to meet the demands on NHS 24 and how many have been recruited in order to ensure that people are not being put at risk when they're being told not to attend A&E and they're not having their call answered at NHS 24?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say, and I'm certain Paul Kane absolutely accepts this, that nobody takes those decisions that NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde and any other health board has done so lightly. They do not put out messaging like that. At a whim, it's a really difficult decision to do so, but it is because of the pressure that they are ultimately under. I visited the NHS 24 site in Dundee, and the recruitment is ongoing, and that recruitment, of course, is to help us to meet that demand. NHS 24 is focused on ensuring that patients receive the correct advice immediately without requiring to be placed in a queue, and have consistently exceeded the 90% target for care delivered at the first point of contact. In fact, the statistics for the 20th of March show that the number was up to 95.4%. So we are making progress, and the recruitment that we're making undertaking at the moment will again help to alleviate some of that pressure.
Siobhan Brown, to be followed by Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think everybody understands the acute pressure on the NHS at the moment, and clearly this pressure is going to have real consequences, not least on the capacity of our ambulance service to quickly get to those in need. And I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's engagement on a case they raised with him recently. Can the Cabinet Secretary therefore provide an update on how the Scottish Government is going to improve waiting times for ambulances?
Cabinet Secretary.
Okay, I thank Siobhan Brown for raising a case with me recently, and let me reiterate what I said at the beginning of my statement, that anybody that has to wait too long for an ambulance and is suffering as a result of that, then I make no hesitation in apologising to them for that inconvenience and for any suffering that they have experienced. And so Siobhan Brown is of course right. The NHS and social care system we have is interconnected, and therefore the pressures that we're facing on A&E of course are having an effect on our ambulance service. But despite the challenges, including managing staff abstraction due to COVID and serving in some of the most rural areas in the UK, in 2020-2021 our ambulance crews responded to over 70% of the highest priority calls in under 10 minutes. and 99% in under 30 minutes. And ambulance crews are saving more critically unwell patients than ever before as well. And figures show that the 30-day survival rate for the sickest patients are at the highest rate, with a survival rate of 53.8%. But I know, me quoting, the improvements that have been made and the significant efforts of our ambulance service may well be cold comfort for those who have to wait a long time. And that's why I took action in the autumn of last year, in the summer of last year, to ensure that there was more additional funding for our Scottish Ambulance Service.
Liam MacArthur to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you very much. Presiding Officer, like others, can I pay tribute to all those working in our health and care services. In January, I asked the Government when self-referrals for the over 70s to the breast cancer screening programme would resume. There was no mention of the resumption of self-referrals in the statement, despite a commitment in January to consider accelerating the timetable. So can the Cabinet Secretary provide a clear timetable for when this service for the over 70s will resume, and an assurance that those who need or wish to be screened, including those in Orkney who are reliant on a mobile screening unit visiting once every 4 years, can be seen without fear of lengthy delays?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can say to Liam MacArthur, we have been actively, and I have been actively engaging with our screening colleagues on this very question, and I have gone back to them to say, well, can we accelerate the over-referral route for those who are 71 and older? I think I did say to him at the time in January that there is difficulty here, that if we were to do that now, it would probably extend the gap between cycles for those who are between 50 and 70. Now, it may be that the amount of time that gap is extended may well not, the benefit risk of doing so actually may be, and it may be beneficial for those who are over 71 in terms of self-referral. So we are looking at this issue. I would hope to have an update, if not in a matter of weeks, then certainly in the very short future. And I'll ensure that Liam MacArthur is kept updated in those discussions.
I call John Mason to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary mentioned the importance of controlling community transmission of COVID. And in one sense, community means the world. It doesn't just mean Scotland. So can he say anything about what Scotland can do, either directly or through the UK government, to help other countries through COVID?
Cabinet Secretary.
It's a fundamentally important point. Time and time again throughout this pandemic, Presiding Officer, we have said that nobody is safe until everybody is safe, and that is absolutely true. And although we are not officially a member of COVAX, we have been in touch with the UK government regularly around how we help the vaccination effort across the world. And we have asked how do we particularly focus some of our efforts in Malawi and in Zambia, where we have, of course, that really important people-to-people relationship. So I want John Mason to know that the Scottish Government is very keen to play its part as a global leader and a member of the global community in relation to vaccinations across the world.
Gillian Mackay to be followed by Craig Coy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In the week ending the 13th of March, 51.9% of people attending A&E in Forth Valley were seen within 4 hours. This is the lowest figure of any health board in Scotland. I know that staff at Forth Valley have been working incredibly hard to improve waiting times, and that January saw remarkable improvement, so it's concerning to see the figure drop again. Forth Valley has one A&E, and demand is simply outstripping capacity. What more support can the Scottish Government provide to Forth Valley and other health boards who are experiencing similar pressures?
Cabinet Secretary.
She's right to say that there have been concerns around Forth Valley, and I've spoken, obviously, as you can imagine, as the Chief Executive and Chair of Forth Valley. What I would say is, though, that Forth Valley, when I look at other metrics, actually manages to perform well in terms of, for example, protecting some element of elective capacity. Forth Valley have managed to do that, where other health boards perhaps have not been able to do that. What I would say is, what I have said to every other member that has spoken, that the best thing we can do on top of the additional investment I've announced is to ensure that we get COVID transmission under control. And we've seen, actually, in the period last year between the Delta wave and the Omicron wave, between October and November, that when we had that COVID transmission under control, we saw that, for example, scheduled operations, there was a significant increase between October and November in scheduled operations. So the ability of NHS to recover and recover quickly, I think, is there, but we have to control COVID.
I call Craig Hoy to be followed by Emma Harper.
I thank the Minister for his statement, which, like his previous announcements, has lots of words but very few actions. The Cabinet Secretary claims that the problems we see in Scotland's health service today are largely down to pressures caused by the unprecedented number of patients in hospital with COVID. But can he say how many of the 2,322 COVID-positive patients are in hospital because of COVID and not only with COVID? And does he have data on the number of people who are admitted without COVID but go on to acquire it once in hospital? And if he doesn't know basic things like this, how on earth will the government set about implementing its flimsy NHS recovery plan or set a new clinical route map to get the NHS back to business as usual?
Cabinet Secretary.
Again, he calls it a flimsy recovery plan. It's a plan his colleagues in Westminster copied. They copied our 10% target because they must have thought it was a very good plan indeed. So I'm not sure why he chooses to call it flimsy. If we, of course, had also listened to the Tories who demanded that we lifted protective measures a long time ago, goodness knows how much more difficult the pressure and COVID would have been. In terms of his question, I've asked Greater Glasgow and Clyde to do another audit similar to what they had done during the Omicron wave, the original Omicron wave, to determine if we can get greater detail around those that are in hospital with or because of COVID. But what I would say is important is that data undoubtedly is. Regardless of whether you're in hospital with COVID or because of COVID, the IPC controls around you continue and remain. And that is what is putting significant pressure on our NHS.
And I call Emma Harper, who is joining us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Due to the success of the vaccination programme, we can move away from legal restrictions and rely on other behaviours. We know the value of appropriate face coverings in preventing the spread of COVID-19. With the possibility of this restriction being lifted soon, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what assessment has been made of the need for people, especially those in clinical vulnerable areas, to wear higher protecting FFP2 type or equivalent masks when in clinical settings or crowded public places?
Cabinet Secretary.
To be brief, of course, Cabinet will have a discussion and come to a decision on the future of potentially lifting the legal requirement of wearing face covering. So that decision hasn't been made and, of course, will be debated in Cabinet, as you'd imagine, on Tuesday with the best clinical and most up-to-date clinical advice that we receive as a Cabinet. In terms of her substantive point around FFP2 masks, I can confirm that we are again, looking at this really closely with our clinicians around whether there is more protection that can be afforded to those at the highest risk through the use of FFP2 masks. So the wearing of face coverings, but also what grade of face covering, is something that is kept under regular review.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the statement on NHS Scotland pandemic pressures, and there will be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.